Welcome to Keep Taking Grow on the Saxophone Podcast. I'm your host, Jesse Ryan, and we're back with season number two. Again, I want to say a huge thank you to everyone that tuned in to season one and commented and shared the episodes and left comments and also subscribed to the YouTube channel and followed us on Spotify. Thank you so much. You guys have really made this something special. And I'm excited to bring you 10 new conversations this season. If you're new to the podcast, welcome. You can expect conversations with award-winning and in-demand saxophonists from around the world and across jazz and contemporary styles. The reason I started this podcast is because I believe that these award-winning and in-demand saxophonists know something that the rest of us don't yet know, and that's what I'm curious about. I really want to create a resource that would help you keep taking ground in your personal, professional, musical, and creative journeys and just generally connect the saxophone community worldwide. So without further ado, today's guest is an up-and-coming jazz saxophonist in New York, currently pursuing her master's degree in jazz performance at the Juilliard School. In 2015, she was awarded a full scholarship to study jazz performance at the Jackie McLean Institute of Jazz within the Hart School of Music. Her college professors included well-known saxophone players Javon Jackson and Abraham Burton. In the fall of 2020, she started pursuing her master's degree at the prestigious Juilliard School in New York. Recently, she's been working with many renowned musicians, including Dede Bridgewater with the DDB Big Band at the Detroit Jazz Festival, Ulysses Owens Jr. And the Generation Y, the Mingus Big Band, Sherry Miracle and the Diva Orchestra, Emmett Cohen, Barry Stevenson, Jason Moran. Just to name a few, she's been playing in venues around New York City, small jazz club, the Harlem Jazz Museum, Times Square, with a series created by the Jazz at Lincoln Center, the Django, Central Park, as part of the Keyed Up and the Giant Steps Art Series. She's also had the opportunity to play with the Alto Summit curated at by the Jazz at Lincoln Center and the Charlie Parker Jazz Festival. She's currently touring globally and plans to release her first leader album this coming summer in 2022. It's my pleasure to welcome Sarah Hanahan to the podcast. Sarah, how are you doing?
Hey, Jesse, I'm doing well. How are you doing?
I am great. Even better that to be having this conversation with you today.
Me too.
You were one of the people that people requested to be on season two. So I put out this call at the end of season one, saying who would you guys like to see on the podcast? And somebody mentioned your name and I think you responded and say, I'd love to do it, you know. So
that's awesome.
Yeah, so it's really a pleasure to have you on here. So let's start at the beginning. How did you get a saxophone in your hand? How did it all begin?
Yeah, oh man, it's crazy to think about the beginning. My father, he's a musician, a really great drummer.
Yeah.
And, you know, he always was showing me music as a kid, a really young kid. And it would be anything from, you know, Motown hits to, you know, Billy Joel, James Taylor.
No, nice.
You know, Jackson 5, Temptations, all this whole array of stuff. Carole King, you know, a bunch of things. And then he loves big band, he loves jazz, and he would show me jazz records in the car. We'd take long road trips and him and I would just be, you know, talking about the music and just, you know, fun things, just like dad daughter type of things. And I just loved the music so much. I loved all kinds of music. I loved singing in the car and I loved musicals and like all that stuff. And we just have fun, the Beach Boys, like all this kind of like fun stuff. But then when I got a little bit older, like maybe around like 6 or 7, I started really liking, you know, instruments. Mm-hmm. And my dad would always play this like fun game with me where he would play a record and then he'd be like, who's soloing now? Like what instrument is that? And I'd be like, oh, it's a trumpet or like it's a clarinet. Or so I started developing my ears like really early.
Yeah.
Because of him. But always was like really fun and it was never it was just fun. We had a good time with it. So when I was like about 7 years old, my dad we used to watch a lot of DVDs and he had these DVDs of the Buddy Rich Big Band playing live at these great festivals in Canada and it was just like great to watch. So he loved those videos and he used to play in them, and I wasn't so interested at first, but then I started like becoming more interested in like sitting down and being like, what is this, you know? Just like, oh, this is, he really liked them, so I kind of wanted to be in on that too. But I remember this moment where it shifted for me, and I was like glued to the TV when he was playing them. And it wasn't, I love Buddy's playing because he's very theatrical when he plays his part. Just incredible to see, and real like prodigy, amazing drummer. But I loved the saxophone. I just remember I really liked the way it looked, you know, because I'm 7 at that point. But I loved the way it sounded, and his saxophone section was just so incredible anyway. And they would just take the most energetic solos, and just everything about it, I just loved. You know, I don't know why, you know, but it just spoke to me. So when I was 7 for Christmas, I asked my dad, you know, I really want a saxophone, you know, and he was, and he pulled the whole thing where like, you know, we opened all the presents Christmas morning, and and then I didn't get a saxophone. I was like, oh, I was kind of bummed, you know, got some toys or whatever. And then he was like, oh, I think I forgot something. And he went upstairs and he brought down my first saxophone. I
And that
was
was at
like,
seven.
yeah, that was at 7. And I just remember pulling it out and, you know, putting it together and just like loving it, like right off the bat. It was never like honk honk, or it was kind of just like always, you know, it was like nice always for me. And yeah, and I always loved the alto. And you know, I know that when you go through school and stuff, you start, a lot of kids start changing over to tenor, or you know, they might, some kids start playing flute or clarinet, woodwind doubles, things like that. But I just all and people tried to get me to do that, and I was just like, no, I'm playing piano. I just loved the alto. Like I just never wanted to change, or so that's kind of how it started, and just went from there.
I feel like if alto is that kind of instrument, like when it chooses you, it's like you kind of stick with it.
Definitely.
I feel like if a lot of times more tenor players like venture into taking up alto after a while, but like when somebody chooses the alto, it's like, yeah, I'm an altoist, you know?
I definitely felt like that. It chose me, you know, at that moment.
Okay, so I mean, you started at a really young age, and it's really beautiful to hear how, you know, your father's influence kind of helped you to, well, help develop that initial appreciation and love for music in general, and which led to you picking up the saxophone. Now, you've had the opportunity just to study and go through many different jazz programs and have many mentors. Can you just take a second and talk about some of those early experiences with jazz education in particular, maybe some of the people that were influential for you?
You mean like more towards like before college, or?
Maybe like before college and even me going through that period of like doing an undergrad too, you know?
Oh, for sure. When I was coming up in high school, I only went to public school. I didn't do like an arts program or anything like that, which a lot of my friends now, they all did like some type of high school or thing like that, that it was like playing music was the big part, thing for them. But it wasn't like that for me. I just went to Marlboro High School in my hometown. Luckily though, we had a great really great music program. And I was able to harness my energy towards that, and I really enjoyed that. I also had some private teachers that helped me along the way, kind of get more serious about the saxophone. But it, I always knew I wanted to be a musician, but it wasn't really until college where I really started, you know, taking it very, very seriously. I was kind of a natural musician through high school. I had good ears, and I loved music. I loved listening to music, and I took lessons and all that stuff. But it wasn't until college where, like I said, I really started getting serious about it and started getting those teachers who completely changed my life and the way that I play, and just gave me so much guidance. So through college, someone who was really important to me was Nat Reeves, great bass player, played with Jackie McLean, Kenny
Kenny
Garrett,
Garrett,
played with Sonny Stitt, just the greatest, some of the greatest musicians, Jeff Tane Watts, you know, all of them. He we always I just saw him last week, and he always reminds me when I see him. We played together actually in Hartford. He always reminds me, he's like, you know, when you auditioned, he when I auditioned for the school, he left the room crying because it,
Oh,
it
wow.
made him think of Jackie McLean. I had listened to a lot of Jackie McLean and loved his playing.
Yeah.
And we just always connected very
Wow.
spiritually. So yeah, during my, you know, first or second year, we started, you know, connecting outside of school and playing. I would come to all of his shows, and he started bringing me up on the bandstand when I was barely ready for any of it. And I'd be standing next to great people like Steve Davis and, you know, Joe Farnsworth and Eddie Henderson and all these like
Yeah.
great people. And I'm like 18 or 19. I'm like, better get it together, you know, pretty quick. So he was a huge influence for me and someone who always believed in me and was always like giving me great opportunities, even when I wasn't ready. Cause that's the things that pushed me to, you know, become, you know, a better musician. And I always say he ruined me kind of because he's such an incredible bass player. And now I'm really picky about bass players because I came up with him, you know, just playing such a powerful beat, such an incredible presence as a person and as a player. And, you know, he really taught me everything I know about the music.
Wow.
So that was great. Just naturally, not by words, but by bringing me up and by playing. We would play in the park for like hours, just duo, and we would play like one song and we would just keep going through it. Keep like, you know, it's such a process, this music. So he was
someone.
I mean,
that's so powerful to have a mentor like that, that was willing to invest that time, because I mean, nothing is more important than that. And I think, I mean, what I'm hearing from what you're sharing is that you pretty much was mentored and was taught process, not just the specific outcomes of playing in a particular way, but the time he would spend with you really would have ingrained that, you know, this is a process, and that idea of mentorship. But I want to also stick a pin here, because you mentioned feeling like if you were unready for certain situations. And I think, you know, music is such a communal thing, and that is the nature of community and family, that we help the others coming up. And I feel like if the idea of, you know, not being prepared for a particular situation, all of that, while I get it, I feel like if that's coming out of really like such a, like a business mindset, you know?
Yeah.
And I just wish we could see more of that kind of thing happening, you know, because I definitely identify with that too. Like, I've gotten so many opportunities that in some ways I wasn't ready for, but that's the nature of what we do, you know, as musicians and the community of musicians.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's really like the lineage of the music and the tradition of the music, is that, you know, you have bands like Art Blakey, Art Taylor, who were taking Jackie McLean, who were taking young musicians and saying, come, I'll show you.
Yeah.
You know, they would be taking them on the road. That's how Nat learned. That's how my teachers learned. Steve Davis, Abraham Burton. He played with AT when he was 18 years old, I think, you know.
Well,
that you're playing with some of the greatest musicians. That's really how you learn. That's really how you learn this music, through osmosis, not through school or through. And, you know, school is great for a lot of things too. Jazz, you know, education is great. But, you know, this music has been passed down through our ancestors.
Yeah.
And that's the only way to really learn it and to really. Yeah. To really be a part of it and to push it forward as well.
Yeah.
You know what it feels like to be with the greats, who were with the greats, You know what I mean? So it's a very deep connection and something I take very seriously.
I can see that on a t-shirt, the greats, who were with the great, who were with the
great. Yeah, exactly. That's him.
A good t-shirt. Yeah. Okay. So what was this about Jackie McLean that attracted you to his playing, you know?
I just remember hearing Jackie in high school. I had a teacher who made this CD for me of his record called 4, 5, and 6. And I honestly never even got past the first song on the record. I don't even like, I still haven't gotten past the first song. This first song is called Sentimental Journey. And I remember just, you know, hearing that and just playing it over and over again. Just the way he plays on it is so incredible, so melodic, and the sound. I just remember being completely captured and like mesmerized by the alto play. Because I love Charlie Parker, and that's really like one person I was checking out a lot was Charlie Parker and Dexter Gordon and people like that. But then when I heard Jackie, I was like hypnotized almost. I was like, what is this? Wow. You know, and I literally don't know what else is on that record because I still only listen to that one because it's like incredible. And so I remember that. And then I think the other thing I heard about from his was this great blues called Bird Lives that he plays like maybe a few choruses on, like five choruses. And it's like one of the greatest recorded solos of all time. It's like just incredible.
I have to check that out. I haven't.
Oh, man. It's okay. Beautiful. It's on his record called Dynasty.
Right. Oh yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And like the melody is like the melody is like, you know, incredible. And then he rips, and it's like meaningful. You know, it's not a bunch of notes. Like he met every one of those phrases. It was like powerful and that level of intensity I had never heard before, coming out of a saxophone. Really. Like that. You know, and I loved Cannonball, and like I love Bird, and they, you know, they each have their own things that I love about them. Mm-hmm. But that kind of hard playing was like, whoa. I was totally taken aback by it, and just by his language as well. He loved Charlie Parker. He's Charlie Parker's disciple. So he took what Charlie, you know, he took everything he learned from Bird and then, you know, continued with, you know, things he learned from all these great people he was around, you know. So his thing is so deep, and I just remember being like, wow, this is totally different. Like, I don't even know what this is, just being completely interested. And then I went to school at the Jackie McLean Institute in Hartford. And then when I started meeting all of these people who played with him, like my main teacher, Abraham Burton, they started talking with me about him and just the legacy, and I was like, wow, this is really powerful. And it only got me more and more into it. I just love his playing, but, you know, just, I think too, going to the school really solidified, like, he's done a lot, not only for the music, but for the community in Hartford. He started the whole jazz community there, and it, you know, it's living today, which is like incredible. So I think that really just deepened everything for me. And, you know, I was mentored by people he mentored. So it's kind of like this waterfall effect of like, you know, I feel a part of that family and that dynasty as well. So
that's amazing. Yeah. You know, the it is so cool just chatting with you about this part of your journey. You know, the name of the podcast is Keep Taking Ground. And I want to kind of shift the conversation a little bit and ask you, what have you been in pursuit of musically, creatively, and like maybe even professionally and artistically?
That's a great question, something I'm searching for every day.
Mm-hmm.
I think as of lately I've been conceptually changing a lot. I think I'm maturing as a person, and so that's really helping my playing mature as well. And I'm also, you know, you just start gaining different perspectives. And, you know, I live in New York, which is like the hub of like great music. Mm-hmm. So I hear a lot of music I love and a lot of music I maybe don't like as much, but I can take things from that too.
Mm-hmm.
So I think right now where I'm at in my process is really kind of trying to solidify like, who am I and what is my voice? Mm-hmm. Which is something that's very important to me because I love the tradition and I love the lineage of this music, and now I want to keep going with it and with the most pride and respect possible. So I think that's something I'm really focusing on in terms of concept, something I'm working on, and something I speak with my teacher Abraham a lot about too. It's been a pleasure because I've been able to play in the Mingus Band recently, the Charles Mingus Band, which has been just an incredible experience. Mm-hmm. But Abe, he plays second tenor in it. So we've been doing this weekly gig, and I feel like I'm back in college almost, where I'm getting like a weekly lesson from him.
Yeah.
Because he's so hip, he doesn't tell him, it's not really about the notes for him, it's about these little things that he'll tell me that will just kind of pull my coat and change my whole, like, oh, okay. Like, I remember a couple weeks ago, I had taken a solo, and he talked to me afterwards. He was like, that was cool. He was like, pace yourself, right? This is little thing. And I was like, and it just was like,
Yeah.
Because he's right. You know, now you get to a certain point where I'm at a certain point where I have a lot of language and things that I can contribute.
Yeah.
But I can't give it all away right at once.
Yeah.
You have to spread it out. It's just these little conceptual things that I've been really working on. Something else I think about a lot is just like melody, melody of the instrument. And I know technique is very important. I'm heavy into that too, but you know, just at the end of the day, like, I want to play something that people remember and makes people feel good, makes me feel good. And for me, that's like just playing really melodic. I know when I play too much or I'm bogging down on my horn, it doesn't feel good for me. I just want to sing and I want to feel like I just happy and like I just want to sing. I don't know what it is. I don't know what we're going to play, but I want to just say something nice on it. Say something that I mean. So those are the kind of things I'm thinking about now, and less about like, what note do I need to play on this D7 chord? I'm just kind of more thinking, you know, broadly conceptually and mostly about my sound, my concept, and who I want to be and who I want to be in this long lineage of incredible musicians. So that's kind of where I'm at with some of the stuff I'm working on.
Amazing. What do you feel is something that has become part of your musical DNA, so to speak?
I think that's a great question. I think there's so many parts of my musical DNA that I've taken little pieces from everybody I've worked with and everybody I've listened to. I think that's a really big thing for me, is like seeing the whole spectrum of like these incredible, well, we have so much information now on the internet and records and stuff, taking little things that I like from everybody and also taking little snippets I like from my teachers and people I trust, you know, people who have taught me and mentored me, taking everything, just being like, okay, file that away, mm-hmm, that away, right? And now I have this kind of ability to not so much focus on what one thing does for me, take a lot of one thing, but have this more, I have a little bit of everything, and now I can be me. So it's hard. Musical DNA, I'm still working on it. I'm still adding to all that stuff, and I'll never stop.
Well, I mean, I think what I'm hearing you say is that that idea of the ability to take many things and synthesize it has become something, well, it has been something that you've been kind of focused on doing. Because I mean, I think in contrast, I've heard some people just kind of focus on one thing, you know?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But I definitely think taking that approach is at the heart of what this music is. And it's also just a smart thing to be a versatile musician, you know? It kind of gives you different perspectives and different skills. To work on. So it's definitely refreshing to hear you say that, and it's kind of a reminder to myself as well. You know, I didn't grow up surrounded by jazz. I grew up in the Caribbean, and so I kind of came to it a little bit later, and my desire to try to learn the music sometimes was a little bit myopic, like, this is what it should sound like, you know. So I'm learning, just kind of open up my palette and check out different things and different approaches to the music and all of that. So it's definitely cool to hear you share that.
I think it's important too, just to add to that, I think it is important too to sit with something for a while. Like, I've sat with many things for a while. I'm still sitting with stuff, like, you know, But yeah, it is. I see a lot of times too, in terms of, jazz education and kind of like younger people, including myself, we get kind of stuck on one track. And like there's so much, like there's so many, especially the saxophone, there's so many textures, colors, approaches, lyricism, think there's so much things you, so many things and approaches you can take to the saxophone. So getting like it's cool, sit with that, but then, for me at least, I'm just speaking for myself, but I like to say, okay, I'm gonna sit with this, but I also like, you gotta check out some other things too, and it's only gonna help you, it's only gonna, broaden what you're already doing, which is really important, and it's gonna, round you out as a player. So
Absolutely.
just my thoughts.
I mean, I love it. What have been some of your favorite experiences, just like working with other musicians, like being on tour and,
Oh man, so many great, experiences. Like, wow. I mean, I mentioned it a little bit earlier, but playing with the Mingus Band has been just such a treat for me lately. Playing with some of like really the baddest musicians in New York and just on the planet, like including Philip Harper, Conrad Herwig, Abraham Burton, Jason Marshall, David Lee Jones, Wayne Escoffrey, just like these incredible, and I so many more that I haven't listed. Donald Edwards, Dave Kokoski, all Luquez Curtis, a bunch of so many incredible people, that it's been so inspiring for me every week to be sitting there and just being like, wow, like looking around, just being like, I'm learning so much. It's great music. I'm learning so much about Charles Mingus's history and his lineage as well, which has been fun for me, checking out all the songs and really diving into the music. I've just been having so much fun. It's been a real treat for me. I've been really enjoying that. And some other things I've been doing, I've been having a great time. I went on the road with Ulysses Owens Jr. a little while ago. We did his Generation Y band, which was so much fun. We went to Bern, Switzerland, and we played a week there. And just every night it was getting hotter and hotter and hotter, and we were just bringing the heat, bringing the fire, and I just had so much fun learning some of his music as well, and learning from him too on the bandstand, and kind of, we would have little conversations afterwards that would be like, okay, cool, like he'd be like, check this out, check this out, and I'd be like, cool, and I'd come back the next night, I'd have something different, so just so many fun times with great musicians, and I'm just really enjoying this process and this part of my life as well, where I'm doing more traveling and more playing. And I always love playing with my band as well, which is like my time to kind of take everything I'm learning and say, all right, now this is what I'm feeling. This is what I'm hearing now. Let's play the way I'm hearing it. But it's all these things that I've been, developing and thinking about. So just so many great, I've had so many great experiences late as of lately, it's been a real privilege, and
How long ago did you move to New York?
So I graduated from the Jackie McLean Institute in the spring of 2019. And then over the summer, I was doing a lot of programs. I did like the Betty Carter Jazz Program. I did Jazz Aspen with Christian McBride and a couple of other programs. So I was gone for a long part of the summer, but around September I was in New York and I had moved and got my apartment and stuff. So I was in New York for about maybe 8 months before the pandemic. And it was a crazy time. I was loving being in New York because I used to drive from Hartford to New York like all the time to see my teacher play, to see like I just loved the music. I was just coming down, and I'd bring my friends, and we'd all drive back to Hartford at like 3 a.m., 4 a.m. or whatever. Just like just total mess, but we just wanted to hear people play, and
How
like
long was the drive?
it's like 2 hours from
Well,
New
it's
York,
not bad.
so it's not bad, but like when you're tired, at like 4 a.m. it's not great either. So So we would like drive out here, and then when I moved to the city, I was like, "This is great. It's all at my fingertips. You know, I just take the train and I'll be out all night." So I just had a great time meeting people. I would play like as much as I could, learn a lot of tunes, just see music, like just hear music. That was like a big thing for me. Just, oh, I gotta hear this person, and that would influence me in all types of ways. So I had a great time for about 8 months, and then I moved right back home. The pandemic hit. We headed out of New York because it was a hot spot. And then I was home for a little while. And I moved back to New York again in August of 2020. So it was about maybe like seven months at home during the bad part of COVID. And then I head back to the city. So it's been a really wild ride for me. I don't even really know how long I've been here. Feels like a while, but it's only been a couple of years, I guess. So little pandemic in between, but you know, still
No,
navigating that.
how far is what was the city you grew up in again? Your
I
hometown?
grew up in Marlborough, Massachusetts.
Marlborough. Yeah, so how far is Marlborough from, let's say, like Boston?
From Boston, it's only about 30 minutes. It's really close.
Cool. Have you how do you compare the two scenes? Like let's say like in Boston. Because I know
It's
that, you
interesting.
know, there's Berkeley in Boston, there's a bit of a scene there. So, you know, like, have you been around that scene?
You know, I grew up kind of like in Boston a lot. I used to play at, you know, a conservatory, the prep school there. And that was great. We did like a big band thing. I learned a lot there. And then and I have friends who went to Berkeley, and like I was always in Boston when I lived in Massachusetts, and sometimes when I was in Hartford as well. But I learned very quickly that Boston is like, it has a great scene. There's like some great places to play. There's a lot of musicians, so you have to kind of like hustle those places. I never really got the chance to because I just was never I wasn't really there. I was mostly just in Hartford, and I was playing in Hartford and kind of just focusing on that scene, which they have a great scene as well. But then when you get to New York, you know, it's like same thing. There's a lot of musicians, but there's places to play, and you kind of you just have to, you know, go out and, you know, do your thing. I think they both have great scenes and are both valuable depending on, you know, what you want to do and where you want to live too. Very different cities, actually, just living wise too. Boston's completely different vibe. And it just depends what you want, but both great. You can make music in both anywhere, really. So,
So we talked earlier about, you know, something that has become part of your musical DNA. You talked about synthesizing all of these different influences. So my guess is that you're really talking about that process of transcribing and listening and just like absorbing all of that. Would you mind just kind of talking about your process a little bit?
Transcribing, I think it's a great tool to, you know, learn the language of the music, and something I still am doing a bit, and in a different way now than I was maybe like when I was 18. And when I was like 18, I would really, or like even younger, I in high school and all that, I would focus on the language of the music of Charlie Parker, the way he addresses certain chords, you know, type of structures, you know, things like that, like real technical, and kind of getting that under my fingers. So now you kind of know how to play on like a rhythm changes, or you know how to address the chords on a blues. You know, you have to get the language. That's a big part of the music, is like the language. It's something, you know, that never ends, and I'm still working on. But like as I was developing more, I realized, you know, that my time at certain points might be better used if I was focusing more on like the phrasing and the sound and like the space, actually. Not so much the notes, but like when he or she is not playing. How like, let me check that out. Let me see like when they pull away. That's really valuable, and something that I'm working on all the time is like when to stop. Not when to go, but when to stop. We're going all the time. It's like, but when to like when to pull away and say, stop. 'Cause you know, train stopped, and it was powerful. And you know, all those guys, Miles, everybody, Everybody. Bird. When Bird stops his phrase, it's like right where you should stop the phrase. It makes perfect sense. You know, but we get, you know, as humans, we get so sucked into the study of like notes, 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 and what to play that we forget about what not to play. So that's something I'm kind of interested in. I'm always transcribing. And I'll transcribe now. More of my transcribing is about listening more than like, can I play this on my horn? It's more just about, I remember one time I listened to Impressions with my teacher and he was like, check this out. Train plays there, stops, plays there, plays there, stops. It was more about the movement. It's kind of like boxing. Like it's more about when you come in and how he ends the phrase. Not so much like, oh, did you hear Train play that F to F sharp? Like, you know, there's so much more to this incredible music and tradition. So that's kind of like more what I'm focusing on now is really listening to some players that I admire and want to kind of ingrain their phrasing and things like on ballads and things like that, how people are playing, you know, because that's really important too, and something I struggle with, but I'm always working on, you know, how like Gene Ammons will play a ballad and he's not playing like bebop lines on a ballad, he's playing like melody and like he's being lyrical, phrasing, you know, and he's playing colors and textures and, you know, he's bending, he's growling, he's playing subtone. Like, now that's how you express yourself on the instrument. People aren't like, they, you know, she played a, they really outlined that sus chord, you know, like it's so much deeper than that. So that's kind of what I'm focusing on right now in my process. And a big part of that as well is just the tone, the sound, something that I really am focusing on as an alto player as well. And I know we're going to dive a little bit deeper into that. Should we do that now?
Let's do it.
Let's do it. So, so I guess just one of the things that you and I were chatting about earlier. Before we played too, is like, before we started is just alto. Alto players listening to alto players. Because like I was telling you, we all get so sucked into like, I love tenor players. Don't get me wrong. I love Train. I love, you know, Paul Gonzalez. I love Illinois Jacquet, you know. The Cats, like Dexter Gordon. I love the tenor. But sometimes too, for me, like there is, you have to accept that it is a different texture, it is a different you know, approach, because like really the horn, you know,
it's definitely speaks different, you know,
speaks differently, right? Exactly. It has it has something else to it, and those guys they knew it, and they were, you know, they were using their strengths with the horn, you know, low B flats on the ballad and like milking it and stuff like that. But you know, Johnny Hodges and great Benny Carter, great people like that, they didn't play a ballad the same way, because it's not really, it's really difficult to, it's not really the same. It has a, the alto has a different milk to it. It has a different tone that you can totally knock people out with it. But you have to, you know, figure out how you're going to do that. So one thing I've been working on a lot is kind of really sitting down and listening to some alto players and, you know, getting that, like, well, I want to play a ballad. With a lot of color and texture, might not be exactly the same color and texture that Gene Ammons is getting on his horn, but it could be, I could kind of do that and kind of do like what, you know, Johnny Hodges does, or what, you know, even the way Bird plays a ballad is like really pretty and like completely different. So how can I kind of get that on my horn and my tonality and what I'm hearing as well? That's something I'm you know, shedding on a lot. So you know, like I said earlier too, it's all about sound. One thing I do that, you know, and I'm just talking about my experience and things that I like, but one thing that has definitely helped me is when I practice, I, not all the time, but I use headphones. So for example, like if I'm transcribing, like a, if I'm, you know, working on a melody of a sunny stint melody, or I really like the way he plays this slow blues or something. I might put my headphones on, and I'll be learning it, and I'm not so focused on the notes as I am about the tone and the sound and the color. So am I matching his color? Can I match his color exactly?
Right.
And that's what I'm going for. That's what I'm trying to do, is, you know, get to the point where the sound really matters, and I'm able to get all these textures out of the horn. Same with Bird. I try to sound exactly like Bird. I'll try to sound exactly like Jackie McLean. And then when I go on and play, I'm not going to sound like any of them, because I'm not them. I'm myself. But I have the information, and I have the sound. I remember one person said to me, let your sound carry you. Like, let your sound carry. Sound is everything. That's what they're going to hear, and that's what they're going to go home with. They're not going to go home with the notes. Like, sound, you know? So that's been my concept lately, and I've been really focusing on that in terms of transcribing, instead of so much about, okay, what am I going to play, or do this in 12 keys. And that stuff is great too, and I'm still working on that, but there's, you know, I go in and out of these concepts and focuses as well.
Yeah, I'd like to go a little bit deeper. I know you have some videos that you want to share to kind of demonstrate that process, because I think this is such an abstract concept in many ways, and I think different people would come at it at different ways, and they might get different things from hearing you share it, but there's something special about just kind of seeing it in practice. I know that I definitely learn a lot by just seeing and hearing someone do something. So would you mind just kind of just sharing some of the videos that you have prepared, and just kind of talking us through how you're thinking about how you're approaching it, and the kind of things you're trying to get out of the exercise?
Absolutely. Yeah. So this first video I want to share.
Yeah.
I did this video a little while ago during quarantine, and I was getting haunted by this melody, by this song. And I was like, what song is this? I just couldn't remember. And it was I'm in the Mood for Love, and it was Bird playing the melody. I just loved it. And so I went and I was like, well, I really want to learn this, and kind of like, what is he playing on this? I was just so curious. I learned it, but I was also at the time too, my sound was a little bit harder, and I was trying to figure out, well, how can I get this sweet sound and tone that Bird is getting, because that was what was haunting me about the song, was his sweet color. No, it wasn't like, oh, what notes is he playing? It's like that, the tone of his saxophone was what was haunting me, and I was hearing it in my head. So I was like, you know, let me see if I can get it like this. And it's some, you know, I'm still working on it, but this was a little video of me trying to emulate him.
Yeah.
You know, in terms of his color and the way he phrases and things like that.
Let's hear it.
Yeah. And that's it. That's all he took. He took two A's, and it was like the most perfect solo. Like, it was just incredible. So, like, even when I'm listening to that back, I'm hearing ways I can improve on the tone. But things that I was doing at that time, like when Bird, when he kind of goes up higher, he pushes a little bit more. Right? So he when he's up higher, he's pushing the air a bit more. And when he's lower, when he's low, it's pushed, but it's kind of it kind of rests a bit more. So it kind of is about the accent, the push, the pull. And I'm noticing that when I'm listening back again, how I could do it more and more intact with him.
Yeah.
There was a phrase in there where he said, Right. Yeah. So it's about, it was about that air, the tone. You're going to approach that differently. You know, the first notes are going to be a little bit smoother.
Give it some more,
come back, give it some more. So those are the things I'm, when I'm transcribing, I'm trying to emulate that. So that if I'm out playing, you know, and we're playing, could be anything, a ballad, polka dots and moonbeams. I might want to say, you know, now I have that timbre, I have that tone. Yeah. I can go, that's an option, you know. I love the notes too, and he plays an incredible solo. those are the kind of things I'm thinking about. So I tried to get that sweeter sound, which is so hard because he's just so incredible. But
I mean, so I really like this as a concept. I found that when I was developing early as an improviser, I tried to get to language without understanding the context of that language, which is the harmony and the situation. Mm-hmm. And I find that for me, you know, and where I am in my development, taking a step back and understanding the context, the harmonic context of the language is more important many times than just the language itself. And I see some parallels here with this sort of attention to phrasing and feeling and sound. So in some ways you're putting less stress, as you mentioned, on the notes that you're playing, but the context or the vehicle for the note, which is the phrasing and all of that, which is, I think, is like the building blocks of the language and the communication. It's sort of like this universally accepted, the universal language of music, the phrasing and the feeling and all of that, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. No, you're right on. Yeah. I mean, you know, it's called a process for a reason, too. You know, there's no right or wrong way, in my opinion, but there's like some helpful steps that can get you moving forward, moving to, like, I guess, the ideal spot of really sounding like yourself.
Right.
But learning language and just the actual language of the instrument, that's of course, that's like the first step. You got to know how to do it and how to go about it. But then, you know, as you start developing that, now you can connect it to, okay, this is the harmony. This is the language that I know. Mm-hmm. These are the sounds or maybe the shapes that I like over this certain harmony, which, you know, I like too. But now you're continuing to develop that. And now you're saying, how do I want to play it? How do I want to phrase what I know? Can I get to more meaningful solos, more meaningful passages, things like that? That's a part of transcribing. I don't think people talk about enough is like the sound and like the phrase and the stops. Like I said, when does Bird stop? You know, he stops and it's hip, and it's like that's right, that, you know, that's what he does, you know. And so that's why the music is so great. It's not just you know, whatever. It's like this is a purpose, this is what I'm trying to say.
It's a conversation for sure. And when I listen to Bird or even somebody like Jackie McLean, Ornette Coleman, Sonny Rollins, or even like Dick Oates, I hear it sounds like speech. It sounds like if they're having a conversation, especially like coming from the Caribbean. I don't know, there's something about like the way that Dick Oates plays that reminds me of like a Caribbean person just speaking, you know, like the way how it flows, you know? And so there is, just be that's something that I really connect with, you know. Do you have another video to share with us?
Yeah, absolutely. I got a couple, and they're all a little bit different, and you know, I'll explain why.
Sure.
This next video is actually I'm playing. Did it go to the next one or? Oh, here we go. This next video is the one that is a video of me playing a Jackie McLean solo that I spoke about earlier, actually. Yeah. Bird Lives. And I had learned this solo, like, I've learned it a lot, and I know it, But when I went back to record this little video of me playing it, I was mostly just focusing on the sound. And you know, all these videos are me recording myself and playing the track in the background, so you can't exactly hear it, but from my perspective, the only thing I'm listening to is like, does this sound like one person right now? Does this sound like, because that's a concept, that's like a, that's a, just a way of learning. It's just a an avenue you can take, you know. Can you sound exact? Can I get exactly like that? Which is great, because now you have that. And you know, you don't never sound like exactly like somebody else, but that's what's special about it, is that like you can really check somebody else out, and now you have that ability, you have that tool, and now you can go be, you know, who you want to be, which is, you know, important as well. But this is me playing his solo, and the thing I love about this solo is the sound of it, the tone, but the phrasing, and also what he plays is so bad. So I'm gonna play this for you.
Cool,
It's really short, it's just a little snippet of it, but
yeah.
That's it.
Ooh, yeah.
So
And
like,
no, I have to go check that
oh man, oh my God, that's one of
out.
my favorites of all time. But the way, even like the way I can tell when I'm listening, this is interesting for me as well to speak about it and to show myself, because I'm actually critiquing myself as I'm listening to it. But versus the bird video, I'm pushing the air, I'm zipping the air much more through the horn than I was in the bird video. At certain points in the bird video, I was adding that. But like Jackie, he was zipping, like zip, you know. So now that's a different approach. So now, you know, if we're gonna, if we're, I'm out on the scene and we're gonna play Cherokee at 400, now I have that zip. That's something that I, now I can do that if I want to. So approach. Also, when he stops, I'm gonna just place a certain part of it, but something I like to, that I think about conceptually as well. This is a blues. We're always playing blueses, you know, in all keys and different things like that. But something I always like to think about, and if you listen to like really like the great people, the last two bars of the blues, like they never really play. They always stop. So it's about kind of stopping at the end. You come back in at the top with your phrase. Doesn't have to be on beat one, but like, there's always this pause at the end of a blues. Kind of let the rhythm section reset, boom, and we're back onto the next. So I'm gonna just show this little part. Yeah, that messed me up when someone told me that one time. They were like, "You ever notice no one, the greats never play at the end of a blues?" It's like, what are you talking about? And so then I, you know, me, I'm like, no, I'm like, no way. So I start going through all these records that I love, Train, Jackie, Bird. They never play at the end of a blues, you know. You know, sometimes they might go into it from there, but it's a part of like, it's a part of, you know, and I'm ne not never, you know, I'm
No, I get it.
exaggerating, but
There's a moment of a sense of rest and resetting that happens in the
right,
freezing.
exactly. So I'm gonna play this part. Hey. Rest, top, right there. So that last phrase. That's it. Let me just back it up a bit more. That's the phrase. And he comes back in at the top. There's a pause. You know, there's like that, you know, so that makes it more powerful. And even this is fast. And he's every chorus, if you check it out, there's something at the end where he says, phrase. That's it. Period. Sentences. It's conversation, like we're talking about. Sentences. Period. Now I'm gonna press the tab button. We're gonna go to the next paragraph. Period. Next paragraph. That's the kind of stuff that is also important about the language of the music, besides the notes and what you're playing, is like the phrase and the stops, you know. So that's another example of something that, yeah, I love about his playing and about all of them, but
I really like this concept, Sarah, just because I think a lot of times there's a good disconnect, sorry, between the developing the craft of playing the instrument and this music, and then just how the average person connects to it. And I think music is a universal language, and these kind of things help make those connections of how people might hear the music and something like that, where just, I think is what I'm trying to say is we're just finding the balance between digging into the craft of the music and then communicating that in a way that's universal. You know, we talk in paragraphs and in sentences and phrases, and in conversation there's natural pauses, and I think there's something about this that anybody could connect to because of that sort of natural approach of like speaking through the horn, you know.
Absolutely, yeah. That, and that's just like, you know, what we're talking about is like kind of something that nobody, that not a lot of people are discussing in terms of transcribing, you know.
Yeah.
It's most, you know, because of the institutions and things like that, it kind of becomes more about just like the what of what you're playing, not how you're playing it.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm always thinking about the how. And I'm always thinking about the feeling. Like, does it feel good? Does it sound good?
Right.
You know, does it... Does it, you know, do I feel good when I'm playing it? Do other people feel good when they hear it? You know, I want to show this last video.
I might
actually show two more really quick ones.
Sure.
This next one is Kenny Garrett.
Nice.
Great, you know, incredible alto player. Kenny Garrett, song that I love. This is from, let's see.
Is it the songbook?
I don't know. I don't think it's songbook. I lost it off the top of my head. I apologize.
Yeah.
I think this might be from African Exchange Student. I have to double check, but this is a great song. This one's called Charlie Brown Goes to South Africa. And I remember
I remember in a second. Yeah, I know the album. Yeah.
Yeah, I can't, you know, all of them are just incredible, but
yeah.
Something I love about Kenny's playing, and I can take away from his playing, I love a lot of things, you know. I'm always, like I said, always taking away from everybody. Sometimes I just love the way that he just sings on the horn. He just My favorite parts of his songs or of his solos are when, like, maybe he just vamps on one chord. I really love the way he can, like, sing on the alto specifically. That kind of, it's emotional. I like that. It's soulful.
The album is called, like, Simply Said.
Thank you. And I remember hearing this song and just being like, wow, there was a certain part of the solo where they kind of, you know, go to this like vamp section. And like every time I hear something that I like of his, I mean, I like all of it, but like there will be some stuff where he'll be playing a ton of changes and it's like super bad. But the stuff that really speaks to me is like the one, like when he'll play on like one or two chords.
Yeah.
Because I just that melody aspect of it, and the way he uses his own voice as well to sing on the alto is really important to, you know, the lineage and the history and stuff. So this is what I was focusing on this video, same, was just sound. Can I get that? He has a completely different sound than Bird and Jackie. And like, can I kind of manage to go on this path a little bit if I wanted to. So this is a little bit of that. Even right there, inflection. Right. And that's all him. That's all, you know, that's what he likes to do. So how can I sing that too? He doesn't just say beat-a.
Yep.
Says we are, right?
Yeah.
Which is like a completely different timbre. Yep. Even the first note, it's very sweet. my line of my own at the end. But that's how I, you know, that's how I'm getting inspired and how I'm, well, now how would I play over that now instead? And that's, I always like to do things like that. Like I'll learn a solo, then I, and like, or something, or like a couple phrases, then I'll play the track, but I'll play what I'm hearing over yeah. it instead. And I'll let, you know, the track will still be going on as normal, which is, mm-hmm. which is really fun. And that's a part of this process for me too.
Yeah, beautiful.
But like, when I'm listening to that, I'm also critiquing myself and saying like, the way that Kenny plays the palm keys on the saxophone mm-hmm. is a little bit sweeter than how I was doing it in the video. I could work mm-hmm. on that. Something like it's very smooth when he plays mm-hmm, it. Mm-hmm. Another thing I hear too is like, he's going from these kind of long phrases to then a little bit more a little more bebop phrases. So how is he articulating those, and how is he tonality, how is he going from one to the other? And he's also making it really fluid too. So how can I go from how can I do that fluidly like he is? So you know, this is all part of like the same conversation, right?
Yeah,
like,
absolutely. You
know, tone.
One of the things that stick out about Kenny for me is like the way how he's able to find this sweet spot in between linear melodic playing and like harmonic sort of playing. Like I remember when I was in high school, one of my first introductions to improvisation is that my high school teacher would give us we'll take a scale and she would give us 3 to 5 notes from the scale and just okay, just use those to create some melodies. And so my initial introduction to improvising was a very, very sort of linear, scalic, melodic approach. And it took me a while before I would get into like understanding the harmony below it and how to play from that place. And so Kenny was a real connection for me between those two things, you know, which is very different, I guess, like the clip you played before with Jackie McLean. It's a different melodic approach, I would say.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, you're right. Like Kenny has those abilities to, you know, he has a deep, deep harmonic understanding. And that also is what allows him to play so melodically because mm-hmm. he chooses to, and that's what's important to him. But he's able to do it in such a powerful way because he does understand the harmony at the same time. If that makes sense. Yeah, but Jackie absolutely. Has that. Jackie and Bird have that same thing. That's where he got it from, really.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
Jackie, you know, he has the ability. Like he's playing the crap out of the harmony on that one thing. But mm-hmm. I'm actually about to show one last video where he's playing this song called A House Is Not a Home by Luther Vandross, like a kind of a pop song.
Yeah.
And he's just singing on it. And I'm trying to emulate
it. I can't wait to hear it.
Yeah. And so I'm trying to emulate it. And so he has those abilities too, to play very melodically and very, you know, soulful. But that's because those gentlemen, they understood the base and the foundation of this is the harmony, this is the language.
Yeah.
Now they're able to do whatever they want with it, which mm-hmm. is so beautiful. And that's really the ideal point that you can get to.
Yeah.
Knowing your instrument, knowing the music, knowing the spirit, the soulfulness so well that you can play what you want.
Yeah.
You know? And I just think that's beautiful. But here's a little version of Jackie McLean playing A House Is Not a Home, which goes to the same point of what we were talking about earlier, just in terms of melody. I only learned the melody of this. He takes an incredible solo on this as well, but like when I was practicing, I was like, I just need to learn the melody. The way he's playing it is like just so powerful. So let me check this out really quick.
Thank you.
singing.
Yeah.
Man. I'm wooing at him, not me.
Yeah,
but he,
yeah.
He is just wow. Like, and I remember hearing that and just being like, wow, like blown away because, like you're saying, because I'm realizing too, I had learned so much like really bad, like burning stuff of his. I heard that and I was like, you know, just jaw dropped, like,
yeah,
playing only a couple notes. And the lines he's putting in between too are like really melodic, like coming right from him, but they address the harmony and the melody so perfectly.
Yeah, it sounds like some stit language in there that as well, but it's just like feels so good. I mean, I think for me, one of the I guess the goals of music, goal is not the right word, but like one of the purposes of music is to cognitively shift us and help us to believe, help us to heal, to trust, to connect with things that transcend us. Absolutely. And for me, that just took me to a totally different place just listening to that. And that's one of the reasons why I think music is so important in society, and musicians and artists are so important. I think that's a really good lesson right now. We're going through a really tough time in the music industry, in the world in general, you know, but I'm going through this pandemic. I know a lot of young musicians, probably some older ones too, but people that are around my age that are having a hard time with seeing their way like through the music industry and being a little bit discouraged about how they would connect with audiences and make music and share music and make a living in music. But that clip right there, I know we're talking about transcribing, but that clip there just reminded me about just the importance of music, you know?
Oh, man, I feel the exact, every time I hear it, I've been hearing it for years, I feel the same way. Like once I rediscovered it when I made that video, I had rediscovered it. And I was just knocked out again, like knocked out, because so much, like everything you're saying is right on. And so much of about the music for me is the feeling and meaning it, you know? And I hear that a lot too, is like how to connect with an audience. I think you can play whatever you want to play as long as you really mean it. Like as long as they can feel how your sincerity and your, just how genuine you are. Just being yourself, being honest, you know, melody, feeling, that's all, it's all there. Spirit, it's all there. That's what makes my heart move the most, you know.
Well,
yeah.
I've had such a great time chatting with you. I feel like if this is probably one of my favorite episodes ever, since the beginning of the podcast. I mean, I can just feel your passion and your excitement for this music and the tradition, and just the little bit you've shared with your process and all that, I feel inspired to keep taking ground in my own personal journey. I have to dig into Jackie and
a little bit more, absolutely,
as well, you know.
I
want to wrap up this conversation by just playing a little bit of a rapid fire question game.
Great. Yeah, let's do it.
I'm gonna ask you a couple questions and just give me short answers. Hard reed with small chamber mouthpiece or large chamber mouthpiece with soft reed?
Big tip, big baffle, medium hard reed.
Okay. To be specific.
Yeah.
Okay. I was gonna ask you something about Neo, but I won't go there.
I'll go wherever you go.
I'll do this. Share with our audience three albums that were really influential for you, two saxophone players that were really influential, and leave us with one piece of advice.
Great. three albums.
Yeah.
Jackie Mac Attack Live.
Mm-hmm.
Jackie McLean. Unbelievable.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see what else we got. Songbook, Kenny Garrett. Great. Just
yeah.
love that one.
Yeah.
Closest to the Sun, Abraham Burton, my teacher.
Oh, cool.
Yep. Love it.
Amazing.
So many more I can't even get into.
Yeah,
I can't
yeah,
even
yeah,
think
yeah,
about
yeah.
the ones I missed right now. But
yeah.
Two saxophone players.
Yeah.
Bird.
Mm-hmm.
You have to because it's
yeah, yeah.
father. I don't know if I can name a second because I have so many in
yeah.
in second
well, I mean,
place.
You talked about Jackie McLean so much in this episode.
Of course, I love Jackie. So
yeah.
many great, so many
yeah.
great saxophone
players. All right, we'll default to Bird and Jackie for
Bird and Jackie. Yeah, we'll default, right? But there's so it's too many to name.
Yeah, yeah. And just leave us with one piece of advice.
One piece of advice:
mm-hmm.
keep being yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Keep being yourself. Be honest and enjoy the process.
Mm.
Never be afraid to grow.
Yeah,
and melody is key. That's it.
yeah. You know
That's
what?
Right.
I'm from this episode. I'm getting so many merch ideas now.
Just
from this episode. I have to rewind and find them all. You know.
Right.
If I ever do that, I have to send you a shirt for.
Oh man,
for
absolutely!
Show.
I'd rock that, man.
Well, it's been such a pleasure chatting with you, Syria. Thanks for taking the time on today to chat with me. And where and how can people connect with you online?
Yeah, I'm a heavy Instagram user and a Facebook user. You can find me at Sarah Hanahan, just my full name.
Okay.
And then you can also find my website, sarahhanahan.com, and it lists where I'm playing next.
Yeah.
You can check out some music of mine that I have on. My upcoming album release is happening soon, but I have some tracks and things like that on SoundCloud. You can find that through my website.
Awesome.
But if you ever want to talk, shoot me a message on Instagram or Facebook, and I'd love to chat.
Awesome. You know, what do you have coming up soon that you want to share about?
I'm actually heading to Switzerland on Monday. Which
oh,
I'm
wow.
really 2 days, which I'm really excited about.
Yeah.
And I'm playing with some great local musicians out there. I'm also playing a couple, great gigs in New York coming up. Playing at Rutgers College with the Rutgers Big Band a couple
mm-hmm.
weeks, the Diva Orchestra in a couple weeks. So
nice,
all good
nice.
Things. It's the spring opens up and it's just glorious. It's so much fun. So a lot of good things coming up. Yeah, it's really fun.